one, take control of me. You're messing with the enemy. Cities two, it's another trick. Messing with my mind, I wake up, chase down an empty street. Blindly snap the broken beast, said it's gone with a dirty trick. It's taking all these days to find ya. I tell you I need you.
Awful. Holy shit. Oh. Day 4 of Tony Hawktober is finally upon us, and I'm fucking stoked because Project 8 is easily one of the worst fucking games I've ever played in my entire life. So, let's see how it holds up.
Right from boot up, the tone is completely different this year. Much cleaner presentation and pure skateboard porn to hype us up. Our good friend Chris Roper is probably upset that they reverted back to the chaotic destructive themes. But then we get to the title screen and... what the hell happened? Clouds? Could the game be any less intimidating? And don't be fooled. Create doesn't mean a whole bunch of modes. The only customization we have this year is Create a Skater. And the fucking state of it! Firstly, we're restricted to 3 different skating styles. Punk, Urban, and Kid. But that's not even the best part. Within these 3 options, we only have a very small selection of items for customization. Only 3 face types and hardly anything that looks good. Why is this so restrictive? Create a Skater was always one of the biggest selling points of this franchise, and they botched it big time. We all remember Squares, correct? While he was a timid, shy little fellow, he still had a purpose. I first created Squares with the intention of testing out custom character modes in video games, because if I can't build this simple but quirky design, then your character creation is fucking bad. And guess what? Project 8 is fucking bad! He looks terrible! I can't even begin to fathom the production meeting over this. I mean, were they actually trying to make it shit? Anyway, we've got something, so let's start the game. The story is simple. Tony Hawk is holding a competition to find the top 8 skaters in town. To progress, you need to gather points earned by completing missions, and depending on how well you perform, the more points you earn. It's straightforward, familiar territory, but what? We're locked into closed off levels again, and not enjoyable ones. They all feel like random shit clumped together into emptiness and nothing flows. But worst of all is that the controls are just plain bizarre. The only way I could explain it is like they tried to recreate the classic controls using the weird physics from Thor as a starting point. I just can't wrap my head around it. So I start doing some missions and they all seem to have some pre-rendered cutscenes that are comparable to the Sega CD. And they can't even align it correctly on screen, how embarrassing. Once we start progressing, we run into Coach Frank, Mr. Jason Lee, who starts hooking us up with Pro Skater challenges. And it seems like now every 2 minutes, we get a phone notification about a new challenge out in the world, followed by more skateboard porn. Why is this a thing? It's like, hey, Paul Rodriguez is in town. Now sit and watch a bunch of skate clips, brand advertisements, literally everything Day One fucking Song has ever done in his career, and Bob Burnquist eating goddamn strawberries. Why do I need to see this? Tony Hawk games have always included real skating footage for sponsor videos and rewards for completing the game, but Project 8 frontloads that shit before any actual gameplay. The only thing even kind of interesting this game does, focusing on pure skateboarding, is the new Nail a Trick feature, hosted by Rodney Mullen, of course. What it allows you to do is flip the board controlling the sticks to create, in theory, new tricks and score massive points. It's kind of a precursor to the controls we saw in Skate, but not as good. They're going in the right direction with this, but when you can't even get the tutorial right and mix up the button prompts back to front, then there really is no hope left. And with the rest of the game just being a calamity of failure and boring repetitive shit, with everything Tony Hawk is known for stripped away and replaced with nothing, Tony Hawk's Project 8 gets 3 out of 10. Ever since I first played this as a young stud, I've been overwhelmingly disappointed with the incoherence across the entire game and the boring repetitive snore fest of an experience.
Yeah, you're right, I skipped some details, but this game ain't worth a fucking thing. You want me to nail a trick? I've got a trick for ya. Wasted my childhood playing that filth. And I didn't even know until recently that I was actually playing the inferior version. Yeah, it's finally time for me to check out the true version of Tony Hawk's Project 8.
Unlike American Wasteland, which doesn't have any major differences across platform versions, the next-gen copies of Project 8 are actually completely different gameplay-wise. But the first thing on the menu that catches my attention is Pro Tricks, so let's start there. All that's here is the ability to watch motion cap tricks done by the pros, with full camera controls. AKA, possibly the dumbest addition to a game I think I've ever seen. You mean to tell me we lost the creation suite for this? At least I can report that Cass has more to offer on the newer hardware. Along with the original three, we also have the styles of Surf and Female, each with more exclusive items. It is an improvement, but the mode overall is still pathetic in comparison to previous games. But getting out into the world to skate and... yes, we actually have a world this time! An open world! The levels from the PS2 version are combined together so naturally, and everything flows really well. With only a few seconds to load in and no loading hallways present, the entire thing is true free roaming, meaning that you can start a combo in one section of the map and take it to the other side. It's weird being so familiar with the inferior version and playing this. It feels like I'm altering my memory or something. It's crazy to think just how different this is to play. It's like classic goals, presented in an underground fashion within a world. Along with the level improvements, the gameplay and controls in this version have also had a fresh coat of paint. All new animations and physics make the entire thing feel more realistic compared to the over-the-top arcade style we're used to, and I really appreciate that. Well, aside from the new bail physics. Oh no. It begins! What is with these physics? Not only can you control your bails, which plays into some missions, but other times the game just sends you flying. Skate 3, eat your heart out.
I'm blown away by the transformation though. No wonder the previous generation suffered so much. They were downgraded from this into something the systems could handle.
Comparing the version shows that the PS2 level still showed signs of a cohesive world being out there, and where individual sections of the map weren't enough, entirely new areas were at least added so that the levels wouldn't feel empty. Locations like the factory and concrete part are much more compact in the 360 version, but on the PS2 are much bigger and even too big in some cases. I used to hate trying to navigate this level, but I must commend their efforts. A lot of issues are still present though. We're still bombarded with promotional crap and pros still show up for a quick cameo and paycheck before completely disappearing. As for everyone else in this world, clearly, they had no idea what they wanted to do. Presentation and controls want to focus on skating, while objectives are hosted by horrific caricatures that still want to be cartoony and zany. Since Thug 2, the franchise has had some sick fetish towards destruction, and even that is still present here. You can't have both, and I think that's the biggest issue across both versions. The series is clearly heading in a more down-to-earth and realistic direction, so conversing with army commanders, mayors of homeless encampments, and evil twins just isn't right, especially when looking at the newer version's updated, realistic approach to controls and animations. Things are naturally going to be stiffer and a little more awkward. I'm fine with that, but you can't have realistic controls in a game still stuck in its fast-paced arcade roots.
As much as I'm really enjoying Project 8 now, something I thought I'd never say, the clash in tones can be troubling at times, and that's not even the worst of it.
I mentioned the very limited loading in this game. Considering the extent of the world, it loaded super quick, but during gameplay, there are a lot of frame rate issues. Like, I'm talking game breaking, hurts your eyes and ruins your combo type issues. It's bad. As soon as you escape suburbia and head out, it's already a problem, but the more locations you unlock, the worse it seems to get in certain areas that are more transitional. Buildings and the placement of other landmarks and terrain are certainly used to hide the fact that not everything is being loaded at once, so approaching these areas head on with a lot of speed and a large combo is normally what kills it, and that's a real shame. Even though the story and a lot of the missions are identical to the version I played as a kid, and do get pretty repetitive in nature, I still enjoyed it more and more the longer I played. But I can't justify praising something that is this lacking in polish. The frame rate issues, awkward bailing system, and various other glitches I encountered are unforgivable. It's clear that this was rushed out with no bigger indicator than the story itself. It's generic. Same old gameplay, same old pros with the same old tricks and nothing more. I do like the idea of earning points by completing missions based on how well you complete them. It's what I think Underground 2 maybe should have gone for instead of worthless point values. But even still, the cold ending with Tony Hawk just doing the same things we've been doing for the past 6 hours really isn't worth writing home about, unfortunately. So from there, with no other creation modes and no real reason to free skate, unless you care about playing as different skaters who really should have been in career mode to switch between once you unlock them, there is just nothing else here of much value, honestly. And even though this game really grew on me with the virtual playground style, the control scheme clashing with objective tasks and the abundance of technical issues, I can't justify giving it a high score. So, the true version of Tony Hawk's Project 8 gets 5 out of 10. Had the game run smoothly, I wouldn't have hesitated to give it a 6, but considering I've given at the very least functioning games lower scores in the past, I can't bring myself to see it higher than average, even though I personally enjoyed it, mainly coming off of this fucking version. It's improved over American Wasteland, but looking where the series stands overall, a messy, unpolished release and its terrible Gen 6 port is a bad sign for the future of Tony Hawk games. And with only one more day of Tony Hawktober, let's get away from this downward slippery slope and take a look at a fun, party-style racing game in Downhill Jam tomorrow. But until then, I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, be sure to leave a like, subscribe, and share. I'm Square Eye Jack, and I hope you have a great fucking day. Thanks for watching.